Oh, I'm here. How's it going, Gene?
I'm doing great. How you doing?
Oh, pretty good. Good to see you again. It's our second round, look like.
It sure does. It sure does.
was a great turnout the other day. But some information that I wanted to include was not, we didn't have a lot of time for that. That last segment was actually an hour. This segment would be, half an hour more concentrated. So once again, guys, Nathaniel Evans, podcast host of I'm the Data. This is also Gene Baez, life insurance annuities professional, right? And today we're actually going to be discussing life insurance and business. Like, what does life insurance and business look like? Because most of the time I hear about life insurance, I just hear about people just passing away, people taking care of their families. But I don't hear about life insurance when it actually comes actually building a business model and actually protecting the businesses that we actually create. So we go out there and create LLCs, sole proprietors, general partnerships and stuff like that. All these things are also attached to life insurance, right? And Gene is here to actually show us how they're connected to life insurance and why it's so important. And this is what we want to discuss today. So one thing I want to ask Gene about is life insurance and business important in this time? And if so, why is it so important for business leaders and owners to actually look at life insurance on a different level than they actually been looking at, from the past?
Great, great, great question. That's a great question. And it is a concentrated segment. Glad to be on your podcast. Thank you. For
glad to have
me again, inviting me back to give some more insight to things that we didn't get to cover in the last podcast. I'm truly delighted to be here and be able to share my knowledge and experience with the public at large. Thank you for having me.
Definitely.
To answer your question is very simple. Okay, a key person or a key man insurance generally goes for the important people of a business. Who are the important people? Well, the owners are the important people, but are they the only important people? No. The people that make the business turn, the people that make the business work, okay, the people that drive the business, the driving force behind the business are the people that really gets insured with a key person policy. So a key person policy is generally a tax write-off by the company. It's purchased by the company because it's a company expense for a key person, also called a key man policy. It generally can describe as an insurance policy taken out by a business to compensate that business from financial loss that would arise from the debt for an existing or incapacity of an important member of business. Okay? To put it in simple terms, a simple form, key person insurance is a standard life insurance or trauma insurance policy that is used for business succession or business protection purposes. It's used to protect the business. So if two people are in business, two partners are in business, should one die prematurely, the business can still go on because the other partner can pay out the other partner, buy the other family out of the business and move forward with the business. It can also help with paying staff to replace that key person in the business. So the business keep on functioning and earning. The policy does not extend beyond the period of the person's unlawful or usefulness, okay? So the person is no longer there, the policy ends. So as long as you're useful to the business, that policy is in force along with the payment, okay? The key person policy is usually owned by the business. The owner for that policy is the business. and its aim is to compensate the business for loss incurred with the loss of income generator. So if an income generator for the business and facilitate the business continuity. So if the business is going to continue operating, it helps fund that continuity of the business. Okay. The key person policy does not indemnify the actual loss incurred, but compensate with a fixed monetary sum as specified in the policy. So exactly what you pay for is what you get when the person expires. Okay. So it's very important that if more than one people is responsible for the day-to-day operation of how the business function and operate, there is some coverage by the company to protect the company and its assets going forward should there be a tragedy or a loss.
So my next question is this. So, you know, a lot of partnerships may take place. Let's say you might have a general partnership and, you know, let's say you have three, you know, business partners. Is it wise to take out life insurance or those business partners?
And is the wisest the wisest thing to do to take out policies on all functional directors of a company? Okay, if they're a silent partner, generally no.
Okay.
Okay. But if they're functional, if their operation, their being, help in the day-to-day operations, the function, whether it's marketing, whether it's serving, whether it's cooking, whether it's being an operational person in the business, in its day-to-day operations, then yes, it will be potent to do. Because if that person is no longer there, it's designed that if that person is no longer there in the business, you can pick up the phone and call an agency and get someone with similar or the same skill sets to continue the business without the business having to go under.
Basically go under. Like, you don't want, you know, one thing as far as like building businesses, from what I've been seeing, is that, you know, businesses, they come and go every day. And there's a lot of different reasons. It could be economics, it could be the accounting, it could be, you know, just the different leaderships and the teams actually didn't get along. But to lose a business because one of your partners passed away and you're not able to actually obtain that, you know, that financial obligation that he had, is a big loss, you know, to the generations, I guess, to your children, because many businesses can actually operate while you're no longer here. And if you don't create safety nets, you know what I'm saying, for the business that you create, then I look at it in a time like this, there's really no reason to create businesses if the businesses are not going to actually be protected through and through. You know, you can have a LLC, you know, you can have this type of business, and you can have partners that, if you don't protect them, are they really your partners? If they don't protect you, are they really your partners? Right? If Gene and I talk about business all the time, and I don't know his family, he don't know my family, then what kind of business are we actually doing? Right? How are we protecting one another as men doing business? If we're not really protecting one another, we're not making sure that one another fall. Right? I believe this time is really critical, especially in a time like this, with all these different pandemics, you know, all these different financial hardships. Unemployment is through the roof. You know, job loss is through the roof. Companies are caving in left and right every time you turn around. That you got to have some type of safety net because none of us are psychic, right? None of us are psychic. So it's like the Most High says, he says, if you obtain wealth, store that wealth in 6, even 7 places because you know not which way the wind will blow, right? So don't think that because you have wealth that it's always going to be there for you, always going to have, you're always going to be able to tap into that resource. If you don't store that wealth up and put that wealth in different places, that wealth, when it's time for that wealth to blow away, it's going to blow away and there's nothing you're going to be able to do about it. But if you have safety nets in place, things like the key person policy, things as far as ensuring that the leaders are safeguarded within your organization, within your company, then everything takes place that you don't know about, unaware, you're able to have springboard to bounce back into position, right? You don't want to see fallen leaders. Like, even me being on the advocacy platforms and stuff like that, you see a lot of fallen leaders, a lot of fallen advocates. And if individual that was prominent in a field, but the leaders, let's say the different advocates that join forces with one another, they don't take out life insurance policies on one another. They don't ensure that one another is actually financially set. It's a guy that I follow all the time on Twitter, Glenn Martin. And he just said something today that really struck a chord with me. He said that if your friends see you struggling and you remain struggling, you have no friends. He wants you to notice, whether you say you're in business with these people or not, they're watching you go through these transitions and they're not helping you create a foundation. That means later on in life, you're not be able to create a foundation for them if they were able to slip and fall. Every man believes that he cannot fall until the action takes place. And businesses are the same way. If you make $50,000 last month, you believe you're going to make $50,000 again the next month. But it's not true. It's not true. I have a cousin that's in Atlanta right now, and he, had a car detailing business. And I was saying certain things to him to put the business in place, to put the things in order. And he was saying, no, I don't need to do that right now, because I got this contract right here. And I said, well, is the contract safeguarded with the business owner? Do you have a contract saying you will work from this time to this time to this time to this time? He said, no, we just got a word of mouth thing that's going on. And I said, no, that's not a good look. I'm like, listen, you don't need a word of mouth contract, right? You need a solidified contract. You don't need a poor man contract. I don't know where they come with these poor man concepts. You don't need any of those things. You actually need to make sure that you safeguard it in your business. And I didn't talk to him for like 6 months. He was doing good. And I called him a couple weeks ago and he said, oh man, I lost it all. He said the guy learned all my tricks and trades of my business. Once he learned it and mastered it and applied it to his staff, he got rid of me. So that big, source of income I had coming in, I no longer have it. He said, I went and bought cars with it. I went and bought motorcycles with it. I said, did you incorporate the business? No, I didn't incorporate the business. Did you create contracts with the different people you're doing business with? No, I didn't create no contracts. I'm like, do you have any business partners that you can depend on where you can work in one place and they can work another? Nah, I like to work alone. I don't want to work with no business partners. I'm a one-man machine, right? And this society, because I wrote articles on the standalone man and standalone platforms, I've seen a one-man machine. You got some people that's nice. They nice. They can do it. They one-man machine and nothing can stop them, right? But that one-man machine need to know that if he ever falls, he's on his own.
I would say this to you, Nathan. It's sad that I would have to use this terminology. Okay, and I'll use two with you, giving that scenario. The first one I'll use is, we people of business have to understand that if we are running a business and we want to be successful in business, documentation beats conversation. If we have documentary evidence of the agreement, then we are looking at longevity of the business. But when you say that, and I don't know your cousin, but when you say that, it makes me remember something. I was on holiday in Trinidad some years ago. And there's this popular street in Port of Spain named Frederick Street. And there was a guy there begging all day. He was sitting there just begging. Homeless, vagrant, as they would call him.
Yeah.
And he was begging one hand during the day. But down there, it's like casinos and bars and pubs and, different nightlife. He started begging with two hands, you know? And, you know, I remember saying to him, when he asked me for some money, I says, it seems like you're doing well tonight. You're begging with two hands. It's not enough for one hand, you're begging with two hands. You know what he said to me? He said, business is so good, I open up a branch. So for those people who wants to be an ILO soldier, I would tell them to learn from the vagrants. Okay? Because they're on this corner begging. And they would leave this corner and go to the next block and beg. Why do they go there and beg? Because business dry up at this corner.
That's correct. The
traffic is over here. That's and correct. They move accordingly in order to sustain themselves. But I have a very powerful statistic on key person that I'd like to share on the podcast today. And as you know me to be a very serious person when it comes to business discipline, okay? According to a survey of small businesses conducted by the National Association of Insurance Commissioners, yeah? Here results now, you ready?
Yeah.
Brace yourself. 71% of small business surveyed indicated that they were dependent on one or two people for their success. They were dependent on one or two people in the business for their success. But only 22% of 71, only 22% took out a key person policy on those people that they depended on their business. So it is a problem. And people want to know why business fail. Why their business are failing. Because they're not putting the necessary things in place. When you decide to buy a key person policy, two key consideration you have to have. Only two, it's not a lot.
Gotcha.
Okay? What is the key person commitment to the company? And what amount of insurance you desire to cover that person. That's it. Only two things you got to consider.
That's it.
Two things to consider. Now, how many people take the time to consider that? How many people look at their bottom line? Okay. What are the potential amount of loss you can have in the business, okay, versus the cost to replace that person that's keeping that business alive.
That's right.
You know, so we need to look at what we're doing in business and how we're keeping our business alive. Don't look at what we can do today or what our business is producing today. What happened when our business is not producing?
That's right. We have to look at that.
But what someone said something? That is why you apply for jobs. You should look. I agree with you, Zachary Green.
That's right.
100%. That's right. You have to look at when you apply for jobs, what kind of benefits come with it.
That's correct.
Okay, and we need to be more sensible as to what we do in making decisions, because there's a lot of key people in business, okay? It's especially important for small business, as the loss of key person could result in the death of the business. When you lose a key person, the business can die.
That's right.
Okay? Key person insurance is a risk management strategy. Okay? You're transferring the risk from the business, okay? You're deliberately passing that risk to another party, which is a life insurance company. And that's something that we need to take into consideration as a key person.
That's correct.
A key person policy is a life insurance policy or illness insurance on a key person in the business. You don't have to be only a partner. Okay? You don't only have to be a partner in the business.
Some employees offer packages that can be taken when an employee leaves the company.
You sure can. They sure do. They sure do. And it depends on what kind of contract you enter into the with the company. And this is where we need to have comprehensive applications, contracts, where people know where they stand and make informed decisions. It's very important that we do that, because a key person policy is no joke in a company. And I agree with the persons that are asking questions on the podcast, because it's important to know that you keep the relationship with your suppliers, you keep the relationship with your clients, even though there's a loss of a general manager. When the new general manager comes in, he can pick up the pieces and move the company along, because the company is not that far off by the loss of the one key person or that key person. So we need to also think about how we're proceeding with our business going forward and what we would like to accomplish by having a key person policy. So, yes, I agree with that.
It's kind of like, you know, you take the time out. Somebody called me this morning and asked me, you know, about creating a nonprofit. You know, I gave them some great insights and things of that nature. And the same the token that you actually take on learning how to create a nonprofit or LLC, you actually have to take the same energy and learn how to keep that business afloat and how to keep the main players in that business protected. You know, I think that's one of the most important things for me being on all these nonprofits, me being on all these different social justice platforms, you know, Close Rockets, you know, Save Homelessness, and do all these different things, is that the inner circles of the people that I was around, I did not see that they branched out to protect each other, you know what I'm saying, in case one person was a four. It's kind of like a 10-minute start on a journey, we only end up with one, like a Martin Luther King, right? We only hear about Martin Luther King, but there were other men that were with Martin Luther King, and there was another man that was beside Martin Luther King that was basically confidants that nobody hears about. They only hear about Martin Luther King. They don't hear about the other men and other women that propelled that man and brought that man to that next level. And I think in all these movements and a lot of these organizations that we be in, they're not protecting the whole person. Like life insurance, whole life insurance protects the whole person. These entities that we are being involved in, these businesses that we're involved in, are essential to protect the whole person. If you're not able to fall and you don't want to fall, then those that's in your inner circle should not fall either.
I agree. I agree 100%. And to Ms. Barkley, your statement is exactly correct. Most employees are not aware of key person and EWL policies, okay?
What's EWL?
Okay, an EWL policy is eligibility for women, okay? At the time of screening and diagnosis, but had a lease, it's more for the income, the age, and the insurance status coming into a company that they can use when they leave the company. They can either have it with them in the company. Some are transferable and some are not. It protects the females moreover in a company, my understanding. But a lot of people take jobs or take key position in companies and don't, for a better word, explore those opportunities. They don't ask the employer about additional benefits such as EWL or key person or key man policies. So it's not something that's widely used out there, but it's available. And more people need to have access to it in the workplace, both private and public sector.
Yeah, because, you know, I've worked for nonprofits, and I've never even heard key person policies or even some of these other forms of disabilities. I believe that even some of the nonprofits I work in actually hide these components. Like, they don't even want...
Well, it's not discussive. Well, listen.
Yeah, yeah.
It's very simple. It's a don't ask, don't tell kind of situation, okay?
That's correct.
If a woman, okay, if a woman is between the ages of 18 and 35, okay, they refer to the poll and she has, cervical screening that's abnormal, okay? It kicks in for that, okay? Family planning, screening, it kicks in for that. But who gets compensated? Which employer makes it part of the
essential components of the organization of employment?
And I agree. And that is right? The reason why we're here educating the general public that these things are available to them, okay? They can get a hold of me. They can call me. You have the number scrolling on the bottom. The licensed professional that does this every day. And I can advise them, help them, or even direct them into the right direction to get such a policy. They have the protection that they need going forward.
And that's really important because, you know, when you're looking at the job market, many people look at the job market as far as money, what they can finance, what they can accumulate. The job market is way more than that, especially if you go in these spaces and you have family, you have wives, you have husbands, you have children, you have dependents that's upon you, whether it might be brothers and sisters, because, you know, life has its own twists and turns. And you can't go into an organization for money, you know. I go to an organization for purpose, you know what I mean, and to achieve things. If I see that they're not according to that purpose, I'm keeping it moving. You know, that's me. I don't.
Yeah, but that's you, Nathan.
No, I'm not
Everyone's situation is different.
I'm not saying everybody's me. I'm saying if I go into a space, I'm going to space for a purpose for me. I need to understand the purpose of why I'm there. I can't speak for every man and every woman that go into play. I work with people that just work for money. I don't work for money. You know, I work for purpose, right? I want to have meaning behind what I accumulate. If I accumulate a dollar, I want to have meaning behind it. Now, I don't want to accumulate a dollar, you know, especially if I'm dealing with people's lives, if I'm dealing in a structure where I'm helping lives grow and redevelop and come to a high understanding. I can't go into these spaces for money. I have to go into these spaces for purpose and for understanding. And basically what I'm saying is that if you go into a nonprofit, you know, even if you're going in for money, understand how you're supposed to be protected. Understand your rights. Understand the obligations that organization may have, you know what I mean, towards you and your family. And if they don't have those components in there, they don't want to share those components, you have to find places that's going to make sure that they safeguard you and your family into the future. Economics only go but so far.
And I agree with that 150%. And what we need to do, and what we should continue to do, is to educate the world at large of what's correct. Available to them. Gone are the days when a life insurance only pays out when you die. Gone are the days when only the big wigs, the CEOs,
right.
Vice presidents, and you know, have the life insurance in the company. Gone are those days. Gone are the days when you get disabled, and if you didn't have Aflac or some short-term disability, you had nothing. waiting for Social Security to deny your claim 2 and 3 times before they actually decide to pay the claim while you were actually suffering. Okay,
that's right.
There are vehicles that are out there that can help you. I mean, we were on my radio show Tuesday night. Every Tuesday night,
awesome show. That was an
we
awesome
on
show.
The show, and you know, we run an illustration. Thank you. We run an illustration. $26.46 for $750,000 coverage. And all you have to be making is $15 an hour to get $750,000 coverage. Now, if the minimum wage is now $15 an hour, hey, are you trying to say to me that 2 hours per month of working, you cannot invest in yourself to have $750,000 face value without any medical to cover yourself and family? And then if you die accidentally,
that's right,
your loved one have $1.5 million. Your dependents can move on. Your family, the people that you love and care for, have enough to move on. They can mourn the loss of you, cherish your memories, mm-hmm, and at the same time, move on and make a better life or a good life based on the legacy that you left for them and the protection that you give to them, the financial protection. You know, if you're the breadwinner in the family or just a contributor to the family, and you know, it takes 3 of us to pay the rent. We talk in New York here, you know, the window, huh?
Yeah, so that's true.
It takes 3 of us to pay the rent here. You know, one of us happens to die. What happens to the other two? Do we make a financial burden on the other two? You know, do we protect the other two so in the future they can have time, future? Forget today. Today, you see today.
Yeah. You know, you
tomorrow is not promised. You know, we're nearly sure that we're going to see tomorrow. You know, but the following day, I don't know what's going to happen. And then when that time comes, then you say to me, oh, you know what? He didn't think about that. Oh, he didn't do it. We should have, could have. And then I'm sorry, but the GoFundMe page is putting a burden on the community to assist because you failed the plan.
Now look what Denise Kosum. How you doing, Denise? It's been a while since I've seen you. Good to see you. She said that's what the Jewish people practice.
Not only the Jewish, and I agree with her, Denny. Denny's, I hope to meet you one day. The Chinese do it, the Jews do it, the Indians do it. I don't know why other ethnicities
the Arabs do it.
So why don't we come together and do it? And this is the reason why Nathan and I, we set out on this journey to educate the world on this. That's true, Ms. Barkley. Yes, you can earn dividends to pay. And we spoke about that also. Maybe you should join us on Tuesday nights from 7 to 9 on Block Talk Radio, and you will see the different types of policies and annuities that is offered, blended policies, term and whole life policies we talk about. We talk about the 7 Mind Stone on that show, and teaching people how to save money, how to invest, and what they need to do. So there are different types of policies. There's IUL policies. There's a number of different options that are out there. Depends on the carrier. I like IUL policies, especially because it have the whole life element of it, and then it have the cash value. I like building cash, 10% interest rate on it. I enjoy that for our younger people. I like high face value so we can understand where we are and where we're going and plan for the future, you know? All these policies are that I sell, I try to align myself with as specific type of policy, but not with a specific carrier or company, is understanding that we don't have to die. The own mentality is we have to die, okay? And in sharing the knowledge, we have to understand that that we need to be more respectable to each other and understand each other's situation and share and impart knowledge with them so that they can understand. I have a financial license myself, whereas I do life insurance and annuities every day, all day long. And we come on Block Talk Radio and now on the podcast with Nathan. And we try to educate people on it because the percentage is so low as to what people do, what they like, and what they know. And a lot of people like to go with what they know and not sure that what they think they know is really what's out there as current. And that's one of the things why we teach learning about your financial DNA with children whole life policies. I think they're great. I love whole life policies for children. I only do whole life policy for children, right, Nate?
That's right. I got one for my daughter.
I got all my kids covered with them because
that's right. That's true.
I believe that our kids are the future of tomorrow. And if I can give them a policy from, I just write one for a 3-month-old. Okay. I like to make sure that the children have policies going forward. They're young. The policies are big policies, $100,000 policy. In fact, I have some quotation here. We got $100,000 policy for less than $30 out there. And it's building up a ton of cash in the background. You know, it's building up a ton of cash that when the child meets 16, milestone number, 16, 18, 21, 25, those policies have big, huge cash buildup in it. I encourage parents when they have the tax return to put extra money into the IUL portion of the policies so you could build more cash for the youngsters. And devise different plans when they have extra money instead of putting it in a bank and getting 0.01% interest rate, how they can get 10% interest rate, 6 to 10% interest rate. So it's very important to look at what we have, where we're going. I am a true believer. You can't sell term to a child. It depends on the age of the child and the product in some states. So I wouldn't think that's a totally true statement that you cannot sell term to a child. It depends on the product and the state. So okay. My personal opinion on it is that we're not based on just New York. We're talking about America as a country, America at large, because we have people throughout America that can benefit from this knowledge that we embark on, imparting on them as to the different policies that we can put in place. There's some policies that are very, very competitive. There's some policies that are tailored just for a specific company that they offer. And, you know, I have access to most of them. I wouldn't say all. I'll say most of them. And they have been very, very good, I would say. I I like the prices that I see, and I like the savings that come out of it. So when you look at the child milestone going to 18, 16, 21, 25, 30, when they want to buy their first home, the down payment for their first home, or the closing cost towards their first home, you know, taking that money is tax-free money. So it's very important to know where you're getting the money from. You know, when you take from your 401k, there's tax implications to that. There's fees and penalties to that. You know, so it's different vehicles that you can use to save money and set up a legacy for your children when they're young, as you and I know. We've done it for our children.
That's right. That's what it's about.
I do it for my grandchildren too. Because it's very important that they're coming. We are not fortunate like other ethnic groups to have millions put away. We are third generation, second generation boomers.
That's right.
What are we going to do? We need to leave a legacy for our children. We need to let our children know what money is, what money can do for us, and how money works.
Right.
So, yes.
We got about 3 more minutes left. And I want, you know, Gene, anybody got any more questions, or, you know, Gene could wrap it up. But, you know, every week or, every, you know, basically every 2 weeks, Gene is going to actually come on a podcast, I'm a Dad, a podcast. We're going to speak about different elements of life insurance, annuities, ways to protect one another. Some of our interaction with only probably be stories, you know, telling stories and generating, you know, insight into other people's lives and the things that actually can occur, you know, at any given time in our lives. You know, everybody believes that they are futuristic, right? They know what the future is, but none of us do, right? Regardless of what you have now, or what you have accumulated, none of us own the future, right? None of us. And we can't determine what's going to happen from this day or even that day. Like yesterday, a woman, she passed away in one of these states, and it was unknowingly. You know, she went to the supermarket to pick something up from her family that she does all the time. Went across the street, a car was at the light, you know, let her cross. As soon as she crossed past the car, tried to get to the other side of the sidewalk, the man did a U-turn and ran her over and killed her.
My God.
And, you know, it was just a weird situation that happened to her. And she was just going to the store. And he was impatient. He was a 31-year-old man. He ran out of the 51-year-old woman. He was impatient. He had somewhere to go. You know, but that was more important than her life. And he actually took her life, waited for the police to come so he could go to jail for murder. Right? And you know, we have to be careful, manslaughter, that they called it murder because they say he intentionally did it. But, you know, so, you know, we have to be careful on how we navigate through this life and what's important to us in this life. And our lives are important, and the lives of those that we say we care about is important. And we have to show forth by setting the necessary things in place to show that their lives are important.
I agree. I agree 150%. And that's what I preach every day, that I'm saying to everyone that they should protect themselves, protect their family. In the case of loss or even injury that cause you to lose your income for one reason or another, I think that you need to put that fail safe in place. I'm a true believer of I'm a true believer that we should have policies in place. I know that there are some companies that see what I deem a child that's not an adult, 17 years old, but they do year nearest to, so it looks at eight as an 18-year-old policy, and give them a term policy that they could have for an extended length of time. But the policy was so cheap, so there was an affordability issue. there, and they were able to get coverage going forward. So there's a number of different companies have different flavors of policies, and then there's different state regulations on certain types of policies. That's why there's not a lot of companies that operate and write insurance in New York. Okay, and there's other states that's, you know, very difficult to write state policies in, based on the some certain company flavors. But I want to say that I feel that everyone should be covered. I think everyone has the ability, especially with this new increase of minimum wage, okay, $15 an hour, set by the federal government. I think that everyone should utilize that that extra money and start somewhere. You must start somewhere. And if you have a policy to cover your family, there is protection there, for financial protection there, should there be a loss prematurely, that your family can move on and make a life and continue to live without suffering or turning to the life of crime and that kind of stuff. Because let's look at our youth crime rate in a state like New York, in New York City, okay?
Phenomenal.
Let's look at it, okay? And then let's look back and see, why did it get there? When did it get there? How did it get there? Okay, and it all comes down to economics, education, and economics.
And you know, we got to close out, but I just want to ask this one question. You know, you said about the youth, you know, the arrest rate is really high. And I've been seeing a lot of youth are, you know, they're dying in Rikers Island, you know, they're committing suicide, they're getting killed by, you know, fellow peers, they're getting killed by correction officers, they're dying from drug overdoses and things of that nature. Would a life insurance policy also protect them even though they're incarcerated? No, for the family?
No. If you, one of the questions in a insurance policy is, are you incarcerated? Because if you're incarcerated, you cannot take out a policy.
I'm saying before they get incarcerated. Let's say you do it before they get incarcerated, then they get incarcerated and they wind up pass away in prison. Is that life insurance still valid?
Well, I can't say yes and I can't say no. I never had experience with that. But I would think if they're incarcerated, they forfeit the right because they're the property of the state at the time of the remand or sentence. They're no longer John Public, a part of John Public. So,
the answer is no, because Crystal also said no, and you said no. And Crystal's been doing this for a while. She's really a real professional. She works with New York Life Insurance, so she's been doing this for a while. She said no, you said no. So, that's really something also, too, to understand that, you know, you take a life insurance policy on your children, they go and do a crime, and then the life insurance policy get wiped out. You know, you might have been investing that life insurance policy for 5 or 10 years, and next thing you know, you just lose your whole investment. You know, so I think that that's really some good insight to even think about, even talking to your children, if you did take out life insurance on them, that, yo, man, you go to prison or something like that, you lose all this investment. So, you know, you want to actually be able to change the narrative on, you know, incarceration and dealing with our youth, and dealing with the monetary aspects that we're all facing in this time. You know, there's a lot of wars and stuff taking place and a lot of different things taking place. So we have to really see our economics on a whole nother level. And I think that these segments that we're actually doing will help a lot of our people in these times to come to a clearer understanding of how they need to move forward and protect their financial lives and those of their loved ones.
I agree 100%. I agree 100%. I think that educating the world at large is very important, that we educate each other and get the information out there. We have the medium to do so, the Facebook, you know, the YouTube and stuff like that. But we need to make sure that we educate the public at large so that they can know what's out there and they can make an informed decision as to what they want and what they want to do. So I think it's also.
And she also talked about them being killed, you know, juveniles being killed during a crime as well, that that can also void the policy. So just some things to really consider.
Well, there's a number of there's a number of things that voids a policy.
Yeah, I know.
Policy has an exclusion period.
Yeah.
Okay. Then there's a whole failure to disclose stuff that's not there. Okay. There's a number of things that we can get into, and then we'll be here for 3 hours. But
yeah, we can't do that.
The main thing is for me is that the public needs to know what is and what is not, so that they can conclude, they can make their decision. Mm-hmm. Okay, I'm not here to make a decision for a person. Right. I'm just here to educate everyone as to what is, so they know what options they have and what they can do.
Gotcha. Yeah, so we know we're going to close out, and you know, this is a live forum. It's open. You know, you find Gene or I on most social media platforms, you know, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, TikTok. We're on there. You see Gene on TikTok dancing. You know what I'm saying? So there's a lot of stuff that's going on that we can see. And if you have any, you know, particular questions you want to ask or topics you want to ask surrounding life insurance or annuities, or even how to protect your family, just reach out to us, you know, ask us what topics those is. We actually put those topics together for y'all. We'll tag you, we'll reach out, we'll let you know what's going on, when it get involved. And we look forward to reaching out to y'all again next week. And Gene, I'm gonna let you close out with what you gotta say.
Well, again, thank you for having me. And thank you for the interview. I love the questions. I love the interactions from the public. Miss Barclay, Miss Green, and
Miss Colson. I see Miss Colson in 10 years.
I hope one day that we can have a round table on real issues, discussing the issue, and putting a tailored plan together for the community which we serve, and expand that that service to the wider community, so we can bring people in to understand what is and what can be for them in the future. Protecting our young ones, our youths, and protecting ourselves is very important.
And our elders.
And our elders are most important. And, you know, people are saying that because they were diagnosed with cancer and they're in remission, they can't have a life insurance, or they got stage 1 diabetes, they can't have life insurance. Gone are those days, is what I'll say to you. There's companies that are out there that will do it for you. All you have to do is give me a call on the number below, 855-411-0424, and I'll be able to help you and advise you so you can protect yourself and your loved one in the future in case of a loss. Thank you again for having me.
Good night, y'all.
Good night.
Take care. Good to see you, Gene.
Okay, but same here.